Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Winter in America, a cultural history of neoliberalism from the 60s to the Reagan Revolution, by Daniel Robert McClure, narrated by Steve Menasche. Introduction. Let me emphasize the quality that seems to me to be an essential feature of the general history of capitalism: its unlimited flexibility, its capacity for change and adaptation. If there is, as I believe, a certain unity in capitalism from 13th century Italy to the present-day West, it is here, above all, that such unity must be located and observed. Fernand Braudel, Civilization and Capitalism, 15th through 18th Century, Volume 2, The Wheels of Commerce. This overview serves to show the institutional embeddedness of the current conflicts. Opponents on whatever side and in whatever faith are not simply discontented. Their discontent is organized, directed, and, cumulatively speaking, very well funded. A cultural conflict this extensively entrenched will not simply fade away. Apart from the ideological passions that are at play, too much is at stake institutionally for that to happen. James Davison Hunter, Culture Wars: The Struggle to Define America. After years of social justice activism, urban unrest, and federal legislation, the 1970s emerged as the first decade in U.S. history when white men, especially white men with property, were forced legislatively to compete with people of color and women regarding political and economic opportunities in the mainstream of American life. As this epochal alteration in the nation's fabric unfolded, the United States, and much of the world, entered an economic downturn related to the global restructuring of capitalism. As it had since the shift from Spain-Genoa to the Dutch Republic in the 1600s, and to the ascending British Empire in the late 1700s and 1800s, and later the United States in the 20th century, capitalism entered a new period of reorganization as decolonization created more nation-states with abundant markets and resources, while civil rights legislation established legal equality between the descendants of the formerly enslaved and former slave masters, as well as between men and women. A driving element of the reorganization of capitalism included the evolution of multinational corporations and finance between the 1940s and 1970s. Pushing against the constraints of the New Deal-era regulations and banking reforms, these economic institutions imagined and implemented new routes for international investment across the 1950s and 1960s. Against this backdrop of an expanding globalization of capital, the post-war white, male-centric American identity and its relationship to economic policies entered a period of flux as the changing ideas and policies related to civil rights-era reforms explicitly questioned the assumptions people of the United States had long taken for granted, from the success stories of the American dream to legendary tales underlining American exceptionalism to the 200-year promise of American equality and liberty finally extended to those previously deemed inferior. Ultimately, this historical conjuncture heralded the unraveling of the prosperous Keynesian-inspired regulatory welfare state at the dawn of liberation, guiding the United States, and much of the world, down the path of neoliberalism. Celebrated for creating the post-war economic boom, The welfare state grew out of the reforms of the Progressive Era, leading to the 1930s New Deal programs implemented during the Great Depression. Finding tentative stability through the relationship between big business, finance, organized labor, and government, many characterized this era as the post-war liberal consensus. Reined in by regulations in the wake of the Depression, large corporations and finance grew out of the stability of the welfare state, but soon chafed against its constraints as the 1950s turned into the 1960s. Despite the centrist liberal foundations of the welfare state coalition driving the post-war economic boom, the needs of business increasingly found champions in the new right as conservatism reawakened after decades of marginalization after the Great Depression. The national conservative swing right in the late 1960s and 1970s opened the space to dismantle the welfare state as Keynesian logic appeared to have died in the maelstrom of 1970s inflation. Conservative libertarian journalist Henry Hazlitt articulated this sentiment in 1969. The solution to our problems is not more paternalism, laws, decrees, and controls, but the restoration of liberty and free enterprise, the restoration of incentives to let loose the tremendous constructive energies of 200 million Americans. Alongside the goal of unshackling free enterprise, conservative champions confronted an old threat: social equality across race, gender, and sexuality. Long a shadow haunting a nation founded on both liberty and slavery, the threat of social equality in the decades after the 1950s forced conservatives to confront founder John Adams' fear of the destruction of all distinctions, the nightmare of liberty to all the masses. As one of the fathers of American conservatism, Adams' conservation of the status quo implied that every man should know his place and be made to keep it. Long secured in the wake of the American Revolution through slavery, the cult of true womanhood, Indian removal, exclusionary legislation, anti-Chinese laws and Jim Crow, white terrorism, both mob and paramilitary, and culture buttressing white, heterosexual male supremacy, these traditional values could no longer hold after the 1960s. For economists seeking to reverse federal intervention on behalf of the working and middle classes, this swelling culture war over social equality provided an important rhetorical route toward achieving their goal of an ostensibly laissez-faire economy. The sudden reality of treating people of color and women as equals after centuries of white male heteronormative supremacy stirred the deep impulses, the traditions of American society, leading to what some have called a backlash. By the end of the 1960s, it was not politically feasible to overtly terrorize people of color through traditional forms of mob or vigilante violence aimed toward socially conservative goals of stripping away newly gained rights as white America did during Reconstruction up through the 20th century in the forms of white pogroms against black communities in cities such as Colfax, Wilmington, Atlanta, Springfield, Knoxville, Elaine, Chicago, Tulsa, Los Angeles, and Detroit. Rather, white rage, as Carol Anderson notes, went to work in the wake of the 1960s in different ways. Southern segregationists laid the bedrock of culture war as they attempted to elude the hypocrisy of separate but equal. As early as 1949, state governments sought to defund education and redirect taxpayer money to private schools, while also using race-neutral language, ability, as ways to negotiate funding. As neoliberalism ascended to dominance after the 1960s, two of its defining elements, privatization and colorblindness, found common cause with the political language of resistance against social equality. Public facilities would be privatized, with these policies of access justified using the language of rights of property and anti-government rhetoric. Colorblind language espousing analytical measurements would institutionally limit access. Eluding the language of racism, these rhetorical shifts contributed toward the conservation of the status quo against the threat of social equality. Moreover, the new language established an affiliation with the corporate world, bristling under what they perceived to be their own struggle to retain rights of property against New Deal-era government regulations. The post-war anti-labor conservative voting bloc grew tighter as segregationists and the reborn conservative movement within the Grand Old Party, GOP, with its traditionally wealthy constituents, embraced the populist authenticity of the South and West to present a common folk image amid its elitist ranks. The economic logic tying these elements together arrived in the manifestos of a group of economists seeking to recreate and institute pre-1930s classical liberalism, the neoliberals. The ideas, policies, and organizations of anti-welfare state conservatives, Southern segregationists, big business, and neoliberals converged in the 1960s and 1970s, finding codification in the 1980s. As capitalism entered a period of adjustment at the same moment legislated social equality became a reality after the 1960s, the inability of Keynesians to address the 1970s economic crisis opened a vacuum filled by conservative and neoliberal economic policies, which ultimately restructured federal interventionist priorities away from the white working and middle classes, as had been the case with the post-war welfare state, and toward the needs of multinationals, finance, and the wealthy. To facilitate one of the greatest American ironies, convincing the white American public to vote away the economic system that shaped their post-war prosperity, economic policies drew on the language of old sentiments derived from the historical legacies of social inequality. Sparked to life in the 1960s, a conservative culture war pushed back against the hard-won gains of women and people of color using the populist inflected language of neoliberalism to tap into the discontent toward social equality reforms. Culture war, writes James Davison Hunter, was, and still is, rooted in the competition to define social reality resulting from the history of America's uneasy pluralism. This conflict challenged the new structures of social equality, with conservatives aiming to retain their advantage in defining the habits and meaning of American culture. In short, the United States ventured into an era Dylan Rodriguez calls white reconstruction, a period in which racial whiteness reformed through the process of nominally abolishing a formerly racist national system, chattel slavery / Jim Crow apartheid, while forming the groundwork for a reformed and reinvigorated white supremacist patriarchal social ordering. Ridding itself of overt racism, this new social order would harvest the residual feelings cultivated during the era of overt white nationalism via the culture war. Winning the culture war meant controlling the language and knowledge defining social and economic reality. For a moment in the 1960s, this control had briefly escaped the grasp of tradition as women and people of color gained legislated social equality with white men. A perfect storm brewed across the 1970s, however, as the raw emotions driving culture war sentiments and seething discontent conjoined with corporate reorganization, neoliberal economic ideas, and the ascending new right to direct populist angst against the redistributionist welfare state as the era of neoliberalism took shape in the late 1970s and 1980s. A driving force for this culture war was the belief that a golden age had passed. This sentiment found reflection at the time through popular media and calls for a renewal of traditional values. In hindsight, a sharp break appears certain, as many scholars mark the 1970s as a significant shift in American history. Woven through the fabric of the New Deal welfare state, this conjuncture burst to life at the pinnacle of legislated social equality and the onset of the 1970s economic downturn. The winds driving this conjecture gestated across the long durée of American history, particularly the aftermaths and legacies of settler colonialism, slavery, and patriarchy, erupting as centuries-old customs suddenly became legislatively censured across the turbulent decade of the 1960s. We see a surrealist glimpse of these gusts in the observations of musician-poet Gil Scott Heron, who noted in 1975, "There is a revolution going on in America, / the world, a shifting in the winds, / vibrations, as disruptive as an actual earth tremor, but it is happening in our hearts. The seeds of this revolution were planted hundreds of years ago, in slave ships, in cotton fields, in teepees, in the souls of brave men. The seeds were watered, nurtured, and bloom now in our hands as we rock our babies. It's midwinter in America, a man-made season of shattered dreams and shocked citizens, fumbling and frustrated beneath the crush of greed of corporate monsters and economic manipulators gone wild. There are bitter winds born in the knowledge of secret plans hatched by Western money men that backfired and grew out of control to eat its own. We must support ourselves and stand fast together even as pressure disperses our enemies and bangs at our doors. We must all do what we can for each other to weather this blizzard." In highlighting the centuries-old processes of U.S. history, Scott Heron suggests the mid-1970s conjuncture signaled an onset of calamity for citizens confused at the swiftly changing times and unable to access the rewards tied to the resurgence of corporate America. Other commentators across the political spectrum also noted the long durée stakes of this moment, warning of civilizational collapse at the onrush of the expansion of democracy and social equality toward the historically marginalized. For conservatives and neoliberals, unfettered free enterprise, a return to the anti-labor classical liberalism of the 1920s, was offered as the healing agent for difficult times. A collision of various momentums driven by the inherited legacies of U.S. history, this conjuncture appeared to rekindle the racial, gendered, and economic struggles and antagonisms stretching back to the colonial era. Winter in America investigates this convergence of deep cultural history with the rise of neoliberalism, when the second light of legislated social equality cast down upon the United States. The first light, the Civil War amendments, did not take, though corporations made good use of the 14th Amendment to obtain the rights of personhood. Treading through the era's complicated and interlaced chaos, the book seeks a systemic view, asking, What does the rise of the neoliberal era look like when placed against the centuries-spanning history of the United States? How might seemingly disparate processes and institutions, such as popular film, music, television, business media, and global business institutions, filtered through the longue durée of American history, paint a cultural and economic portrait of the U.S. in transition? And how do these expressions represent what it felt like to lose the omnipotence of white male supremacy after centuries of legislated entitlement? Finally, how might these cultural breadcrumbs lead us to a better understanding of the evolution of neoliberal ideas and policies after 50 years of implementation? Exploring the interconnections between the conservative culture war against newly gained social equality and the onset of neoliberal economics sheds needed light on the lingering longue durée shadows still haunting the interplay between culture and economics in the 21st century. In the years after the 1970s, neoliberalism advanced from a marginalized capitalist ideology to fusing its worldview deep into everyday life, almost to the point of passing as the ideology of no ideology. How might we see this course of change? How might we give language and knowledge to an era that has since melted into normalcy? Unemployment and inflation across the 1970s offered a much-needed opening for neoliberal ideas to translate into federal and state government policies, facilitating what poet-musician Gil Scott-Heron called winter in America. Upon leaving the decade of the 1970s, the middle and working classes witnessed a significant decline in earning power and wealth accumulation in the 1980s and 1990s. The wealthy, on the other hand, did extremely well. As the third decade of the 21st century unfolds, the resulting unrest from the failures of neoliberalism to foment economic prosperity beyond the wealthiest segments of society across the United States and the world has led to various brands of populist conservatism and authoritarian policies. This uncertain atmosphere makes it vital to understand how the deep continuities of American history blended in the 1970s to foster an economic change that both reversed the post-war welfare state's economic focus on the working and middle classes, as well as mobilized a culture war derived from a carefully cultivated memory of this welfare state. Traditional histories of neoliberalism examine its evolution after the 1930s and 1940s as a transnational political philosophy and system of economic, political, and cultural relations. In describing the U.S. variant of neoliberalism, scholarship notes the period of institutional consolidation in the 1950s and 1960s, the work of scholars at the Chicago School of Economics, and the growing dialogue with the New Right. As Keynesian economists failed to address the economic crisis of the 1970s, neoliberal ideas increasingly found acceptance in news magazines and political circles, and finally into a bipartisan arrangement between Democrats and Republicans, tying together the economic logics of President Reagan, H.W. Bush, Clinton, W. Bush, Obama, and Trump. As a successor to the classical liberal ideas from the late 19th and early 20th centuries, the dominant theoretical premise of neoliberalism rests on a fundamentally free market, unfettered by government intrusion. Far from the elimination of government, however, neoliberalism in practice has merely redirected the state's prerogatives away from the public welfare of Keynesianism and toward a state working on behalf of private capital through the protection of property, subsidies, tax breaks, hardline law enforcement practices, and sometimes military coercion abroad. The primary theoretical features of neoliberalism include a combination of deregulation and privatization, justified in the name of competition, the elimination of bureaucratic inefficiencies, and the unfettering of the market. The logic stems from Friedrich August von Hayek, who asserts Philip Murawski declared that the market was the greatest information processor available for humankind. In many ways, this concept bypassed the Enlightenment's belief in rationality and planning to rectify the debilitating consequences of capitalism. For neoliberals, the market acts as an unbiased allocator of knowledge. In short, the market does the thinking for us that we cannot. A notable deviation from the liberalism of Adam Smith includes neoliberalism's acceptance or disregard of concentrated or monopoly capital. With the knowledge-generating market guiding the ostensibly laissez-faire economic path, the reorientation of state functions away from social safety nets to a more pro-business approach to government regulation in the 1970s and 1980s favored the fortunes of American multinational conglomerates, the global financial services industry, and the wealthiest segments of society, contributing to a level of wealth inequality not seen since the years leading up to the Great Depression. Murawski offers a succinct outline of neoliberalism's successful strategy for political and economic ascendancy. Neoliberals aimed to develop a thoroughgoing re-education effort for all parties to alter the tenor and meaning of political life. Nothing more, nothing less. Neoliberal intellectuals identified their targets, which in Fabian tradition had been described as elite civil society. Their efforts were aimed primarily at winning over intellectuals and opinion leaders of future generations, and their primary tool was redefining the place of knowledge in society, which also became the central theme in their theoretical tradition. The policy outcomes resulting from these ideas include pro-corporate support of the free flow of capital, the redefinition of the state's prerogatives toward markets and capital, the freeing of markets from democratic interference, and the assertion that the market is better able to produce information and services than the state. Adding to their belief in the market as an information processor, neoliberals and conservatives presented these economic programs as moral codes grounded in the notion that pronounced inequality of economic resources and political rights were a necessary functional characteristic of their ideal market system. This latter moralizing of economics found common cause with the conservative culture war over social equality. One of the most powerful attributes of neoliberalism rests in its ability to cast a reformist image of capitalist society supporting the needs of big business and finance, while articulating this program through the populist language of small-scale, small-business-community relationships. This populist conservative identity imagined the small guy seeking liberty against the tyranny of big government, cementing the moral code of neoliberal economics as an economics for ordinary people against elite government intrusion. Draped in an outsider's garb, a duster perhaps, neoliberalism's use of populist conservatism regenerated an American innocence disavowing the institutionally racist and sexist elements of American capitalism's recent past dramatically unveiled throughout the civil rights era. A stance that drew working and middle-class white people, whose lives were battered by the Depression at the end of the GOP-led 1920s classical liberal era, into the ranks of post-1960s conservatism that ushered in a return to the policies of inequality they thought they had escaped after World War II. The strained denial of New Deal-inspired welfare state policies contributing toward shaping affirmative action for whites, including federal programs facilitating a massive transfer of quite specific privileges to white Americans, is one of the many ironies of the post-civil rights era and its contemporary memory. Jefferson Cowie notes the pre-tax income of the bottom 60% of households more than doubled between 1949 and 1979, tracking neatly with rising productivity. In describing the source of warm remembrance, Cowie continues, "Keynesian economics gave a shared logic to economic growth, and the modern industrial labor movement appeared to have finally solved the labor question for the indefinite future. As a result, more income, more equality, more optimism, more leisure, more consumer goods, more travel, more entertainment, more expansive homes, and more education were all available in the post-war years to regular people than at any other time in world history." Although these programs produced economic and social opportunity for favored constituencies, because of the racial calculus, they also widened the gap between white and black Americans in the aftermath of the Second World War. Finally, the gendered assumption guiding the welfare state was the family wage, where men were envisioned as the breadwinner and women were seen as dependent on the man's income. Women's independence from men was never a part of the welfare state's logic. Within this rhetorical denial of the cultural and economic logic of the welfare state, populist conservatism provided neoliberal policies with a potent mixture of familiar, ruggedly individualistic American history, summoning images of the past to cast an innocence on the culture war against the social equality legislation that dismantled the racial and gendered policies of the 1950s and 1960s. Balancing upon this tension, the cultural economic characteristics of the rise of neoliberalism in the 1970s included two often antagonistic ideas: formal equality and complete faith in the marketplace. The blend of colorblindness and the rights of property aided the culture war's intention to deflect the race and gender-based criticisms of society and business. In particular, colorblindness and the rights of property reconfigured racial antagonism toward blacks and other people of color by censuring vulgar or overtly racist rhetoric, positing the inherent biological inequality of African Americans, and replacing it with a colorblind language espousing market guidelines, analytical measurements, or simply the rule of law. All important concepts for neoliberalism's argument against government intervention in matters of property and wealth. Through this prism, inequality could be framed through the workings of a market or quantitative analysis, an ostensibly race and gender-neutral arena of commerce. Discrimination might be attached to a lack of skills, a product of economics, while it thoroughly ignored the unequal access to acquiring skills, a product of an exclusionary cultural politics. Thus, this colorblind framework focused on an abstract equality of access to theoretically free markets, with the invisible hand of whiteness finding concealment behind the abstraction of ostensibly impartial quantitative analysis, market efficiency, and the desire for a profitable enterprise. In short, all faith was placed in the information processing power of the market. The material outcomes associated with the decades and centuries of virtually white male-only access to the outlets of economic prosperity simply disappeared from debate when measuring how exactly markets would reform their logics whose origins lay within a racialized and gendered U.S./global capitalism. Unwilling to address this legacy, the faith in markets encouraged neoliberals to assume that all gains for white Americans in the post-war years were cultivated through a ruggedly individual work ethic and not a system adhering to the nation's centuries-old tradition of white male supremacy. Thus, in the absence of the history of racism, white homeowners after World War II simply made a market choice to live and work in the suburbs, while black people did not. Racist federal and state policies, let alone white terrorism, appeared to have no hand in maintaining pure white neighborhoods. David M.P. Freund notes that federal interventions did more than simply structure opportunity. Paradoxically, they also helped popularize the idea that government interventions were not providing considerable benefits to white people. Public officials, their private sector allies, and even federal appraisal guidelines assured whites that state interventions neither made suburban growth possible nor helped segregate the fast-growing metropolis by race. They promoted a story that urban and suburban outcomes resulted solely from impersonal market forces. Not surprisingly, white homeowners, particularly in the suburbs, embraced this narrative and made it a central refrain in local debates about housing, race, and inequality. This disavowal of institutional racism enabled countless white people to insist that their support for exclusion was not a racist act. As this market-centered ideology surfaced in tandem with legislated social equality in the 1960s and 1970s, the retrenchment of federal intervention in the Nixon era, what was called benign neglect, absolved the need to address the still-embedded inequalities untouched from 1960s civil rights legislation. Ibram X. Kendi describes the road to the Civil Rights Act of 1964 as one where supporters of the act agreed on outlawing future discrimination, but disagreed on what to do about past discrimination. A past now solidified with worker seniority, housing subsidies for all white suburbs, and access to higher education. There would be no compensation for African Americans who were legally held back from starting the race for the American dream, whether in the post-war years or Reconstruction or enslavement. Meanwhile, whites found solace in the new social equality by forgetting their centuries-long head start. More insidiously, the act helped to deregulate the way racial discrimination operated by defining racist policies via public intent versus public outcomes. Kendi adds, by not principally focusing on outcome, discriminators had to merely privatize their public policies to get around the Civil Rights Act. With newly legislated freedom, the 1970s could now be imagined as year zero for racial and gender equality. By the 1980s, federal enforcement of civil rights was thoroughly undermined by the Reagan administration under the guise that discrimination no longer was a factor in the lives of non-white people. One of Reagan's favorite theorists, George Gilder, offered this soothing announcement in 1981. The last 30 years in America have seen a relentless and thoroughly successful advance against the old prejudices, to the point that it is now virtually impossible to find in a position of power a serious racist. Problems remain, but it would seem genuinely difficult to sustain the idea that America is still oppressive and discriminatory. Neoliberalism thrived amid this backdrop, with various sets of cultural processes bridging the gap between a conservative reaction to social equality legislation and the arguments of neoliberal intellectuals. Accordingly, a crucial avenue to understanding neoliberalism asks how we might map out the dialogue between the ascension of neoliberal ideas and policies and the longer durée existential jolt of the first decade of legislated social equality between white men, women, and people of color. As we understand culture to be a shared system of symbols, gestures, and communication passed generationally within societies, another larger question asks, what buried cultural roots were mobilized in reaction to legislated social equality? And how did this conjuncture regenerate and reform language and knowledge from the American past in the service of contemporary policies designed to dismantle the welfare state and usher in neoliberalism? Operating both consciously and unconsciously, culture organizes and makes sense of people's lives, including economic decisions measuring gendered, sexual, or racial difference. Learned through socialization, culture gains efficiency when people think through its tenets, operating as an unconscious prism, an ontology, interpreting the world through language and gestures deemed universal. In this sense, U.S. culture operates through frameworks Michel Rolfe Triot calls North Atlantic universals. The sets of language and knowledge established through the administrative and violent relationships derived from the legacies of colonialism, the Atlantic slave system, and capitalism, which coalesced into a Eurocentric interpretation of the world in the wake of European expansion. Out of these developments arose ostensibly neutral concepts, including progress, development, globalization, and even the very idea of modernity itself. North Americans inherited these ideas, influencing the culture of capitalism and naturalizing unequal power relationships demanded for the maintenance of colonial society and the United States. Across centuries, Triot writes, the cultural expressions interlaced through these activities fostered a particular way of seeing the world, an ontology anchored to ambiguously conscious and unconscious ways of remembering history to account for the present. They do not describe the world. They offer visions of the world. They appear to refer to things as they exist, but because they are rooted in a particular history, they evoke multiple layers of sensibilities, persuasion, cultural assumptions, and ideological choices tied to that localized history. They come to us loaded with aesthetic and stylistic sensibilities, religious and philosophical persuasions, cultural assumptions ranging from what it means to be a human being to the proper relationship between humans and the natural world, ideological choices ranging from the nature of the political to its possibilities of transformation. Winter in America peels back the intricate layers weaving through the centuries-old history of the United States and traces the various ways they manifested during the conjunctional crisis of the long 1970s and the rise of neoliberalism. The outcome of settler colonialism and slavery, the first layer, includes the status quo racial laws and culture of the United States and their intensification in the late 19th and early 20th centuries through scientific racism and Jim Crow segregation, leading to a more formidable system of racial wealth inequality, the welfare state. With the institutionalization of what I will refer to as the Jim Crow welfare state, whiteness regenerated its ability to accumulate wealth and opportunity, as it had since the 17th century, creating homeowners out of the white ethnic working classes and fostering an unprecedented prosperity and standard of living. The Jim Crow welfare state's primary constituency was white men, with the economic system designed to buttress the family wage, including the Cold War containment of women within the home. Although this era is immortalized as a golden age of prosperity, for people of color, the post-war years remained synonymous with the previous centuries of racial antagonism and second-class citizenship. A second layer included the political reawakening of multinational corporations and finance after a brief lull during the Depression and World War II. These large institutions of capital actively participated in creating American post-war hegemony, taking advantage of global decolonization to enter new markets while profiting from federal intervention in the economies of the United States, Japan, and Europe, the Marshall Plan. Post-war libertarians often pointed to these federal interventions on behalf of big business as one of the significant reasons for the perpetuation of the welfare state. However, despite suggesting that big businessmen cannot necessarily be relied upon to be their allies in the battle against extension of government encroachments, conservative authors like Hazlitt really had nothing to fear. Indeed, they underestimated big business's approach toward reorganizing the state's prerogatives. In short, corporations were hardly confused or full of timidity in their relationship with government. Rather, they were good businessmen using government for their own ends. Although the welfare state provided stability and a demand-side economic approach benefiting the spending power of ordinary Americans, the regulations associated with federal intervention increasingly became burdensome to multinationals and their financial partners in the 1960s and 1970s. The welfare state had saved capitalism from its depression and created a strong consumer society around a secure white middle class. But a new economic framework was needed. In this sense, the evolving needs of big business conjoined with the economic prescriptions of neoliberals. A third trend grew out of the reaction to the redistributive effect of the New Deal-derived Jim Crow welfare state, the rebirth of conservatism after its crash in the Great Depression. The New Right, shaped by figures such as William F. Buckley, Jr., sought to break apart the liberal consensus holding the Jim Crow welfare state together. The 1960s civil rights legislation dismantling, or using the language of neoliberalism, deregulating the racist and sexist laws upholding the centuries-old traditions of white male supremacy, provided conservatives with a significant opportunity to break apart the liberal consensus through the mobilization of a Southern strategy, what Matthew D. Lasseter reimagines as the Sunbelt South suburban strategy, targeting the very demographic who benefited from the Jim Crow welfare state. Southern segregationist Democrats joined with the Republican Party, where a rejuvenated conservatism attacked federal intervention, particularly on issues of racial equality and the previous right to racially and sexually discriminate in the realm of culture and economics. The party of Lincoln initiated a long-term engagement in racial coding, using the deeply embedded American sentiment of anti-blackness through colorblind language to break white Democrats away from supporting pro-welfare state politicians. Although many saw their votes against the welfare state as votes taking away welfare payments to poor people, most often coded black or brown, this demographic shift away from the support of the welfare state represented a counter-revolution against a vibrant post-war American economic system that actively funded infrastructure, education, healthcare, and other social spending programs targeting white working and middle-class Americans. Seen through the prism of the culture war, whites now voted against the system, largely responsible for shaping their post-war prosperity and opportunity. Viewing their federally subsidized, racially segregated suburbs as a class-based outcome of meritocratic individualism, rather than the unconstitutional product of structural racism, the suburban strategy imagined government intervention through social equality legislation as an unconstitutional exercise in social engineering and an unprecedented violation of free market meritocracy. This populist conservative reaction facilitated the political space for neoliberal ideas and policies to be woven into the nation's fabric. By the 1980s, the structures were in place to reverse the distribution of wealth away from the post-World War II downward trend. Moving in the opposite direction, under the path charted by conservative and neoliberal economists, the redistribution of wealth upward returned the United States to the type of wealth and income inequality not seen since the 1920s classical liberal era. Neoliberalism, modernity, and the longue durée. The conjuncture leading to the neoliberal era needs to be understood within the wider historical frameworks in which it developed. The way culture weaves through capitalism, allowing the economic system to present itself as an unquestioned natural development. More than just economic relationships born out of a market system based on private property and profits accumulated through trade, capitalism exists as an anchoring component of the cultural economic system of modernity. The set of intersecting historical processes taking shape after the 1400s. Colonialism, settler colonialism, the Atlantic slave system, capitalism, the Enlightenment, the nation-state, and imperialism. Driven by European expansion, capitalism evolved through these material and ideological structures, leading to various sets of cultural institutions establishing the archive of language and knowledge, shaping ideas ranging from nationalism to the Enlightenment, as well as the intersectional hierarchies of race, gender, sexuality, and class, among others. Neoliberalism and the neoliberal era inherited the racial, gendered, sexual, and class assumptions and antagonisms derived from the previous 400 years of North American history, becoming the latest formation of this deep, what Fernand Braudel called the longue durée, outgrowth of the system of modernity, and not merely as a set of ideas related to monetary systems and trade discussed in the isolation of 20th century economic textbooks. Situating these developments within long-term structures of thought, sets of policies, and their material outcomes, the longue durée is central for understanding the set of cultural economic changes circulating through the United States as neoliberalism fused into American economic common sense after the 1960s. The longue durée sets the history of events, histoire événementielle, into a larger framework, one encompassing an analysis of history across centuries, noting economic, cultural, and environmental changes that evolve slowly, often imperceptibly, over time. In this sense, the longue durée spurs important sets of questions for understanding the rise of neoliberalism. One way the deep past influences the justification of contemporary policies includes mobilizing Janus-faced universals to justify unequal relationships, including Western civilization, an idea evoking a cultural or biological superiority of people of European descent, generally designated masculine, while simultaneously supporting abstract tenets of liberty and equality. Using the epical righteousness of Western civilization as a justification for present policies summons a set of language and knowledge in which the present assumes an innocent relationship to the past. As universals, this language conveniently veils the crimes against humanity involved in the very material outcomes and ideological meanings shaping Western civilization from the processes of modernity. Out of earlier precedents defending slavery, segregation, and patriarchy, we see this continuity in the language of the culture war when policies target historically marginalized groups, women, people of color, or the LGBTQ community, and find justification through the familiar defense of Western civilization trope. From the perspective of 500 years of modernity, Winter in America outlines how the rise of neoliberal capitalism amid the first decade of legislated social equality found validation through carefully constructed ideas, such as Western civilization. From this long-durée vantage point, we may understand what historians call the white backlash as not a mere backlash, implying a level of unfairness forced on the rights of white people, but rather a white re-entrenchment of long-embedded entitlements and privileges accumulated across centuries of American history, described by Anderson as white rage, or what Rodriguez calls white reconstruction, or what Richard Maxwell Brown calls the socially conservative goals of vigilante or mob violence. In short, massive resistance against political and economic equality between people of European descent and people of color defines the longue durée of American history. It was not an aberration of the period, but the legacy of the deep historical momentum of what Michael Omi and Howard Winnett call the racial dictatorship of U.S. history. Using the longue durée, we may appreciate the existential magnitude of the impact of social equality legislation upon the minds of those who historically could gain access to the fruits of the American dream since the 1600s. The civil rights era dismantled or deregulated the legal frameworks upholding this centuries-old common sense. Further, we must add male to this historical entitlement, particularly white males with property, to be fully accurate. Thus, if white males, especially those with property, were forced to compete for economic and political access for the first time with people of color and women after the 1960s, a cultural reassertion of power, informed by the specters of white nationalism, would inevitably appear as a reaction to the legislative dismantling of centuries-old norms, traditions, and economic relations. The reaction to social equality legislation, then, is also a crisis of identity, as deep customs of deference to white male authority slowly eroded in its ability to dictate norms in the face of social equality legislation. The loss of power that once seemed to be distributed through the laws of nature pressed into service the conservative culture war, as the loss of authority, to quote Hunter again, to define social reality, led to a battle over the possession of language and knowledge to retain their advantage in defining the habits and meaning of American culture. The culture war took special aim at the government's failure to protect 300-year-old entitlements for white Americans, deeming social equality legislation as an infringement upon the rights of white citizens. While white masculinity found potency under the welfare state, social equality legislation presented government policy as a betrayal against deep American traditions, opening the door for white beneficiaries of the welfare state to begin voting against it. The historical roots of American white masculinity emerged from the violence of frontier settlement and a slave Jim Crow segregation economy. Greg Grandin characterized the frontier in American society as a proxy for liberation synonymous with the possibilities and promises of modern life itself and held out as a model for the rest of the world to emulate. However, the faith in believing the frontier could shake off Americans' circumstances was the exclusive reserve for white men in this myth. The moment of liberation for formerly subjugated people, especially all women, presented white men with an existential crisis over an identity long defined through their entitlement to define their liberty and freedom through the subjugation of others. The frontier had yet again been closed as Jim Crow no longer protected the economic opportunities of white men. When people long deemed inferior became legislated social equals, the traditional ideas of white masculinity trembled with impotent uncertainty. They no longer legally meant anything. As James Baldwin noted in The Devil Finds Work, the oppression of others justified the freedom and autonomy of white men since the 1600s. However, when the prisoner is free, the jailer faces the void of himself. As the prison in which the jailer guarded and historically found meaning in was dismantled, with the formerly caged and beaten now deemed legislatively equal. The conservative culture war gave voice to this reaction to 1960s social justice movements, as the more progressive forms of the civil rights and women's liberation movements constructed an intricate set of language and knowledge challenging the normalcy of white male supremacy and its relationship to capitalism. White masculinity often claimed injury in the wake of social equality legislation, a rhetorical maneuver that protested the erosions of white men's historical advantage while denying that advantage ever existed. Summoned to defend the status quo, the culture war aided in the reformation of the now outdated language of domination with new, colorblind, gender-neutral language, tying a large demographic of people uneasy about what would later be called multiculturalism or diversity to the rhetoric and logics of neoliberalism. Gestures and statements from films, television, music, or business magazines often come filled with an inherited culture derived from the deep past. A close examination of these longue durée layers unveils a genealogical dialogue tying cultural economic eras together, what David Armitage calls transtemporal history. Within these moments, we may glimpse the sequences of contexts framing the way agents operate, using language and knowledge to deploy ideas. This vantage point encourages a history in ideas rather than history of ideas, where the focal points of arguments shaped and debated episodically across time with a conscious, or at least a provable connection with both earlier and later instances of such struggles. Thus, as overtly racist or sexist language became censured, coded words connected to past meanings of inferiority took their place, resetting older ideas of inequality under new language acting as an umbrella of innocence, denying past or current crimes. Winter in America tells the story of this transition in capitalism and relationships between white men, people of color, and women in the United States, where the tension between the contemporary reforms of civil rights and white intransigence to social equality provided a cultural language coalescing with the rise of an economic system built around the needs of corporations, the finance industry, and the wealthy. The book outlines and theorizes how popular media projected these forces, creating a space where new language reinforced and rehabilitated old habits of thought. As the victories of 1960s social movements bore some fruit in the 1970s, the American paradox of inequality in the land of the free found kinship with the arrival of neoliberalism. On the one hand, the 1970s saw African Americans, and especially white women, make inroads within state and civil society after centuries of exclusion. On the other hand, new institutional forms and structural conditions of hierarchy adapted to hard-won gains through a process of deregulated discrimination, not only reframing ideas of race, gender, sexuality, and freedom itself, but also weaving progressive reforms into the logic of neoliberalism. Taking Scott Herron's title of his 1974 LP, Winter in America, as a metaphor for the onset of the neoliberal era, Winter in America analyzes and contextualizes the intersections of these micro-historical processes within the larger framework of the history of capitalism. The chapters consist of a series of case studies analyzing the intersections between the rise of neoliberalism, popular media, and the longue-durée cultural language connected to slavery, settler colonialism, and patriarchy. The book takes seriously popular media as both a conscious and unconscious set of cultures recreating and reimagining the present through the deep logics inherited from the past. Drawing from multiple popular media sites, Winter in America brings together the pages of BusinessWeek with the late period output of John Wayne, American exploitation movies produced in the Philippines to neoliberal envisioning of freedom through the weathered concept of Western civilization, the feminist politics of films such as 9 to 5 and Born in Flames to the poetic performances of Gil Scott Heron and Jane Cortez and the early years of hip-hop. These sources provide windows into the careening culture representing the dawn of neoliberalism. The first chapter of Winter in America, American Innocence Through the Possession of History, James Baldwin, William F. Buckley, Jr., and the 1965 Cambridge Debate, examines the 1965 debate between James Baldwin and William F. Buckley, Jr., setting a theatrical tone for the book. This chapter analyzes the performances of Baldwin and Buckley, focusing on the various ways different understandings of history were mobilized to engage with the debate's topic, has the American dream been achieved at the expense of the American Negro? Baldwin specifically notes the curious way history is possessed in the service of those who dominate groups considered inferior. Embodying the possession of history, Buckley's response to Baldwin's assertions justified the conditions of African Americans through a deployment of a selective past in order to secure an innocence for the present. As a representative of the centuries-old Black radical tradition, Baldwin framed the civil rights movement and its grand task of dismantling American racism through a longue durée framework, underscoring the deep legacies of anti-blackness inherited from slavery. Buckley, a founder of the modern conservative movement, rallied a different longue durée view of history, utilizing conservatism's defense of Western civilization and its notions of order and hierarchy as a justification for downplaying the extent of racism in America. Buckley's use of Western civilization both denied its contribution to the construction of racial inequality, as well as dismissed the need for any action of remediation in the name of social equality. The arrival of neoliberalism against the backdrop of racial and cultural unrest appeared to mimic earlier eras of upheaval, including Reconstruction and post-Reconstruction, which saw significant capital concentration and a sharp rise in white racial antagonism and racist legislation. Most of Andrew Johnson's Northern and Southern audiences had been raised in the church of Andrew Jackson's primitive simplicity and purity, with its already racialized understanding of the federal government, when any publicly administered social program would be seen as but an opening for extraneous corrupting influences. So their shared, already understood animosity to the Freedmen's Bureau, which needed nothing but laughter and hisses to convey, made it easy for the president to shift all the many problems of post-Civil War America, its corruption, concentration of power, low wages, and inadequate housing, onto African Americans and their bloodsucker advocates in Congress, radical Republicans such as Thaddeus Stevens and Wendell Phillips, who were trying to fund the Bureau. As neoliberalism replaced the economic system that helped shape the American middle class after World War II, these faint longue durée echoes surfaced. The language and policies of the federally directed welfare state primarily benefited white men, a pattern consistent with legal and cultural practices since the 1600s. The puzzle, of course, is how neoliberalism, born in reaction to the Jim Crow welfare state, was voted into place using language directed towards systematically dismantling the very framework sustaining the white middle class. It is in this political-cultural arena where we see the struggle over the possession of history as a critical attribute for understanding the culture war's usefulness for the rise of neoliberalism. Buckley's defense of black inequality at the dawn of liberation helped shape a receptive audience for the language of neoliberalism. Privatization, connected to the deregulation of public space after civil rights legislation, pioneered, of course, by Southern segregationists, deregulation challenged government oversight of business and the lives of whites uncomfortable with desegregation, and a strict belief in a colorblind market obscured the federally directed welfare state spending that developed the white suburbs and concentrated people of color into impoverished inner-city public housing. Under privatization, deregulation, and colorblindness, failure in the face of an economic program redistributing capital upward would reinforce older ideas suggesting that some groups were inferior or incapable of competing in the post-1960s world. The meeting of Baldwin and Buckley neatly ties this struggle together, with the latter helping to establish the theoretical baseline linking the shift in discussions of race from overt ideas of white superiority to notions of cultural pathology. For conservatives, this cultural turn replaced scientific racism with ideas assuming that some groups were not culturally equipped for full equality. Or, as an earlier era of overt white nationalism might articulate, they were neither civilized nor ready for social equality with white people. The defense of Western civilization, with its attendant ideas of liberty and freedom, arose as an important cultural argument mustered by neoliberals and conservatives to justify their critique against the welfare state. Titled, Did You Ever See a Dream Walking? Western Civilization, the Longue Durée, and the Culture of Neoliberalism, Chapter 2 examines the way the processes of modernity wove through the cultural undertones of the writings of Friedrich August von Hayek and Milton Friedman. In particular, the chapter explores the intersections of 20th-century conservatism, the New Right, and neoliberals, and how they summoned the history and ideas of Western civilization to vindicate their ideals. A close reading reveals a culture valuing both the ideas of liberty and freedom while assuming social equality outside the transnational community of white men was a cause for alarm, an echo back to the American conservatism of John Adams. The chapter establishes a brief history of neoliberalism's evolution in reaction to the welfare state, including the neoliberal possession of history, the disavowal of the racial and gendered exclusions ignored by neoliberal writings in their discussions of freedom and tyranny. This disavowal of the extent to which racial and gendered antagonisms shaped American history, including European or people of European descent domination of the world in early 20th century, established the baseline cultural norms dominating conservative and neoliberal rhetoric after World War II. Chapter 3, The Jim Crow Welfare State and the Corporate Revolution, Postwar American Capitalism, outlines the economic evolution of multinational corporations, conglomerates, and the finance community after World War II. As a cultural interpretation of the institutional history of post-war big business, this chapter emphasizes an often overlooked element contributing to the rise of neoliberalism: the actual economic policies developed by multinationals and finance across the post-war era to negotiate their way through the various regulations of the welfare state. These transnational policies brought to life the networks of economic activity neoliberal ideas conjoined with in the 1970s. Rather than envisioning the onset of neoliberalism leading to the expansion of corporate and financial power, this chapter underlines the extent to which the Jim Crow welfare state provided a secure space for the economic growth of big business. Adapting to the regulatory structures of Keynesianism, post-war corporate policies envisioned and implemented the new needs of capitalism for which neoliberal theory justified in the 1970s and 1980s. Once no longer useful, corporate America shed the hull of the welfare state like a snake sheds its skin. From this macro view of post-war capitalism, the next chapter changes to a micro view. Using articles and editorials from BusinessWeek as an entrepot to the shift from the Jim Crow welfare state to neoliberalism, Chapter 4, The Idea of Doing with Less So That Big Business Can Have More, The Culture and Ethos of BusinessWeek, traces the evolution of business culture between the 1960s and 1980s. In particular, this chapter places many of the assumptions and arguments advanced in the first three chapters into the language of the business world, including its interaction with the culture war, 1960s social justice movements, and the unfolding economic crisis of the 1970s. The chapter also notes how BusinessWeek increasingly embraced neoliberal and conservative economic ideas and culture war tenets across the decade. Through a reading of films involving John Wayne in the 1960s and 1970s, the fifth chapter, Go West and Turn Right, Settler Colonialism, Neoliberalism, and John Wayne's Possession of History, explores the populist conservatism anchoring the culture war. Specifically, this chapter examines the connection between populist conservatism and one of the foundational processes defining American identity, the legacy of settler colonialism. The chapter highlights the paradox of celebrating the romantic heroism of settler colonialism while simultaneously silencing or disavowing the history of ethnic cleansing and gratuitous violence aimed toward people of color, including the policing of domestic enemies such as African Americans. These settler colonial white nationalist imaginings also revere the masculine patriotic warrior culture of the settler and his family, with the equation assuming that white women were in need of protection to preserve the homeland from savage others. A vital anchor to this system includes the equation of feminine deference to masculine authority, a bond sealed through the anti-black practices of lynching black men accused of raping white women. This feminine deference implied a relinquishing of women's rights to men in the name of protection. Populist conservatism proved crucial for the American acceptance of neoliberalism, as its rugged, individual, militant masculinity pulled together the white working and middle-class male demographic who equated patriotic righteousness with an American nation historically catering to their needs. From Indian removal to the Homestead Act to the post-war white suburbs, The rugged toughness of this populist conservatism, moreover, acted as a balm for the existential crisis related to the relinquishing of legislative superiority and control toward people of color and women. The myths of rugged individualism and male heroism imbued much of the rhetoric pressing neoliberal ideas into policies, as they were defined against a so-called dependency-laden, feminized, and racialized welfare state regulatory system, despite its well-documented privileging of white men. Chapters 6 and 7 focus on the various reactions to women's liberation and second-wave feminism in the 1970s and 1980s, including the way neoliberal ideas, corporate prerogatives, and the culture war formed a nexus. Chapter 6, Blood, Breasts, and Beasts, The Feminist Liberation Gauntlet, and Flexible Misogyny at the Dawn of Social Equality, outlines how women became the convenient targets for those anxious about the legislative victories of 1960s social justice movements. Working through both feminist and misogynist representations, the chapter explores music and American exploitation films, especially those made in the Philippines by U.S. companies who outsourced production overseas and imported these movies back into the United States, a defining strategy for American corporations after the 1960s. Through this embodiment of an industry relocating overseas to a regulation-free environment, this chapter theorizes routes for women's liberation against centuries-old patriarchal systems, especially in terms of gendered violence. I utilize the concept of a liberation gauntlet to suggest that liberation for women in popular culture often took the form of violence or humiliation, rooted in old patriarchal patterns of violence against women's bodies, on the way to empowerment. Chapter 7, Does Militancy No Longer Mean Guns at High Noon? Feminist Dialogues, The Corporate Woman, and The Dawn of Neoliberalism, examines the restructuring of boundaries for women's liberation, characterized in BusinessWeek's Corporate Woman column and the acceptable assimilation model seen in the film 9 to 5. In contrast, the black feminist-inspired independent movie Born in Flames offers a more systematic critique of capitalist patriarchy. Through the intersectional dynamics of these films, with Network added as a bridge between The Liberation Gauntlet and The Corporate Woman, the sixth and seventh chapters underscore the adaptability of capitalism, suggesting that the corporate reforms characteristic of neoliberalism enabled a narrow middle-class, multicultural set of previously excluded people to find opportunity in the post-civil rights world, which blunted the most radical of systemic critiques emanating from 1960s and 1970s social movements. Returning to the black radical tradition embodied by James Baldwin, the final chapter analyzes the work of African-American spoken word artists, particularly Gil Scott Heron and Jane Cortez, and their contemporaneous critique and identification of the neoliberal economic system across the 1970s and 1980s. Alongside African-American spoken word, the chapter connects this movement with its Black Atlantic offshoots in Jamaican sound system and DJ styles related to reggae and dub music, as well as the ascendant 1970s hip-hop culture arising in decaying, capital flight-afflicted post-industrial urban spaces. In the post-Black Power United States, the Black radical tradition continued its centuries-old role in providing language and knowledge, countering the coercive aspects of modernity as it entered its neoliberal phase. Together, these chapters limb the evolution of American capitalism from the Jim Crow welfare state to neoliberalism between the 1960s and 1980s, addressing the question, What did the culture of the rise of neoliberalism look and feel like? The second frontier of post-war prosperity for white men had closed in the 1960s, leading to white Americans both defending a status quo constructed through the Jim Crow welfare state, while also reveling in nostalgia for the time of innocence before the end of the frontier, before the civil rights movement made white nationalism self-conscious, before it was named and condemned. These are the cultural roots of the neoliberal era. Chapter 1. American Innocence Through the Possession of History. James Baldwin, William F. Buckley, Jr., and the 1965 Cambridge Debate. It was this Africanism, deployed as rawness and savagery, that provided the staging ground and arena for the elaboration of the quintessential American identity. Autonomy is freedom and translates into the much-championed and revered individualism. Newness translates into innocence. Distinctiveness becomes difference and the erection of strategies for maintaining it. Authority and absolute power become a romantic conquering heroism, virility, and the problematic of wielding absolute power over the lives of others. All the rest are made possible by this last, it would seem. Absolute power called forth and played against and within a natural and mental landscape conceived of as a raw, half-savage world. Toni Morrison, Playing in the Dark. What one needs to consider is the individual who stands to suffer. William F. Buckley, Jr., pro-Negro discrimination encouraged. The nation's dual origins in slavery and freedom imbued modern conservatives with a deep sense of cultural authenticity, and Northerners and Southerners alike held fast against the quest for inclusion. They saw no contradiction between claiming to stand for liberty and opposing the Black Freedom Movement because they revered a tradition that silenced and subordinated Blacks. Nancy MacLean, Freedom is Not Enough. 1965 materialized as another year promising the continued economic growth of the preceding two decades. By then, the post-war Keynesian mixed economy consensus, the set of welfare state policies developed out of the 1930s New Deal, had become the dominant economic and political norm for the nation. Historian Kim Phillips Fine asserts, "On the national level, the spring of 1965 was a high water point for liberalism." Indeed, as James T. Patterson described the year, "No people in the modern history of the world had had it so good." Smoldering beneath these positive economic signs, however, was a range of discontent as African Americans and other people of color continued to navigate the restrictions and state-sanctioned violence defining Jim Crow America. Meanwhile, white America confronted the uneasy prospect of legislated social equality with the very targets of their Jim Crow America. The title of Patterson's book, The Eve of Destruction, named after the folk rock tune Eve of Destruction by Barry McGuire, aptly describes the cresting tidal wave about to flood through American society in 1965. Various flashpoints interrupted the celebrations of the good life anchoring the largely white suburban American dream. The assassination of Malcolm X in February, the violent setbacks for the civil rights movement in Selma, Alabama in March, coinciding with the official invasion of Vietnam in the same month, and the Watts uprising in August, just days after Congress passed the Voting Rights Act. Caught in both an inherited and self-made tragedy, the U.S. public, at the very height of post-war prosperity, continued to walk through a fog of exceptional innocence, failing to take responsibility and account for the racial antagonism sustaining an American dream atop anti-black sentiments and institutions inherited from the days of slavery. The material space in which to enact these dreams, of course, evolved through centuries of displacement of indigenous peoples and Mexicans via settler colonial policies. The reenactments of these historical processes of displacement and enslavement, generally framed as heroic white masculine deeds, found warm reception from radio, film, and television consumers across the nation, creating an imagined history where the violence of invasion was converted into the innocence of settlement. Free from the wanton greed and hatred demanded to secure white American freedom and liberty across North America. These accumulated depths of history, however, appeared to come due in 1965. The relationships between white America, material well-being, and a normalized oppressive society protecting this dream had found regeneration across the centuries. The ideas woven through settler colonialism and slavery and its aftermath rhetorically supported a sense of white innocence, obscuring the legacy of violent racial antagonism defining American identity. Patricia Nelson Limerick charts how innocence was imagined via westward expansion, writing, "The dominant motive for moving west was improvement and opportunity, not injury to others. Even when they were trespassers, Westering Americans were hardly, in their own eyes, criminals. Rather, they were pioneers. The ends abundantly justified the means. Personal interest in the acquisition of territory, and those interests overlapped in turn with the mission to extend the domain of Christian civilization. Innocence of intention placed the course of events in a bright and positive light. Only over time would the shadows compete for our attention." This identity of free, autonomous whiteness juxtaposed itself against unfree, enslaved blackness, naturalizing ideas of difference and the erection of strategies for maintaining it, as Morrison notes. These ever-evolving, centuries-old practices define an important part of the identity of American whiteness. During the post-war years, welfare state policies reimagined this identity through federal interventions subsidizing white suburbanization and economic opportunities aimed toward white males, using the gendered language of the family wage. By the end of 1965, it was increasingly obvious that the deep currents of institutional anti-black racism interlaced into the framework of the welfare state and the post-war American dream clearly needed more than legislation to remediate the structural second-class citizenry of African Americans and other people of color in the United States. One of the period's leading critics connecting the American dream to the nation's legacy of anti-blackness was the African-American author James Baldwin. Baldwin's systemic critique of the relationship between racial oppression and economics appeared in full force through his nonfiction writings between the 1950s and 1980s. He summarized the entanglement of culture and economics in his 1971 dialogue with poet Nikki Giovanni. "It's very hard to recognize that the standards which have almost killed you are really mercantile standards. They're based on cotton. They're based on oil. They're based on peanuts. They're based on profits. Because, you see, the reason people think it's important to be white is that they think it's important not to be black. They think it's important to be white because white means you are civilized, and being black means you are not civilized. What I'm trying to get at is my apprehension of the crisis of this age. The crisis has something to do with identity, and that has something to do with buried history. People invent categories in order to feel safe. White people invented black people to give white people identity. As an outgrowth of racial capitalism, anti-blackness evolved through the twin dynamics of economics and culture, with the concepts and policies of slavery and freedom generating a sense of value in both human worth as well as profits, whether the value of the enslaved or the value of the product produced by the enslaved. As Jared Sexton writes, if in the economy of race, whiteness is a form of money, the general equivalent or universal standard value, then blackness is its gold standard, the bottom line guarantee represented by hard currency. Marked socially dead from the initiation of the United States of America, black people were envisioned as non-citizens from the start. From the 1790 Naturalization Act to the Dred Scott decision in 1857 to the foundation of the Jim Crow welfare state. Plessy versus Ferguson. Slavery provided the labor demanded for sustaining European transnational enterprises, while the slaves themselves were converted into exchangeable currency and measurements of wealth. Black enslaved bodies were worth $3.5 billion in 1860, making them the largest single financial asset in the entire U.S. economy, worth more than all manufacturing and railroads combined. In short, social death for blacks equaled massive wealth for white America, later to be translated into the terrorism of racial domination, marked by lynching and the rise of crime statistics, justifying the criminalization of blackness. In the mid-1960s, a yawning gulf appeared through the celebrations of civil rights legislation, blatantly exposing the institutional racism hardwired into the very fabric of the infrastructure supporting the American dream. In response, the buried history, long celebrated by white Americans in their popular media, burst forth to defend the racial calculus still intertwined in the socioeconomic structures of U.S. society at the dawn of legislated social equality. The second Reconstruction had reached its bottleneck, as the crisis of identity, wrapped in the old spectral identities haunting American history, found renewed life amid the historic deviation from Dred Scott and Plessy versus Ferguson. Baldwin confronted this shift head-on in 1965 when he debated William F. Buckley, Jr., one of the major architects of the New Right and an important figure helping to shape the culture of neoliberalism. This chapter situates the 1965 debate as a crucial moment of dialogue reflecting the long-term contradictions of American society, as well as a preview of how the United States would address racial inequality as civil rights legislation reformed, or deregulated, to use the language of neoliberalism, the legal framework of Jim Crow. On one end, a man of Irish descent and the era's conservative standard-bearer who steadfastly stood, athwart history yelling stop, at a time when no one is inclined to do so, during an era of civil rights activism. On the other end, a descendant of formerly enslaved peoples who pressed his pen into service on behalf of the era's civil rights movement. Performing in the nation, England, that coordinated the destinies of both men's ancestors, Baldwin and Buckley operated as vessels of the larger historical conjuncture spanning the 1960s and 1980s. Sponsored by the Cambridge Union Society, Baldwin's debate with Buckley on February 18, 1965, in England, represented an important signpost reflecting the evolution of the ongoing American paradox of slavery and freedom 100 years after emancipation. The debate topic asked, "Has the American dream been achieved at the expense of the American Negro?" With two Cambridge students debating the two sides, and an audience of over 700 students filling the Cambridge Union's debating hall, the event touched on the core cultural intricacies of racial inequality, the history of the African-American experience, and the intersection of these processes with American capitalism. The program's host, Norman St. John Stevens, MP, described the momentous event, exclaiming, "Hundreds of undergraduates and myself waiting for what could prove one of the most exciting debates in the whole of 150 years of the Union history, I don't think I've ever seen the Union so well attended. There are undergraduates everywhere. They're on the benches, they're on the floor, they're in the galleries, and there are a lot more outside clamoring to get in." An excitement resounded through the Cambridge campus as one descendant of European ancestry and one descendant of African ancestry debated the legacies of slavery and its connection to economic opportunity within England's former settler colony, the United States. Taped by the British Broadcasting Corporation, BBC, and later broadcasted by the National Educational Television Network, the precursor to public broadcasting system, the setting was visibly claustrophobic, with a sea of students filling the television screen. The debate's relevancy, in hindsight, signaled an important cultural shift stirring through American society in the mid-1960s, marking the beginning of the end for institutional American racial reform. 1965 witnessed the initiation of significant challenges against the further erosion of institutional racism that had become the focus of the Black freedom struggle. Throughout the debate, the long shadow of slavery and its ideas of anti-blackness pressed heavily on Baldwin's and Buckley's arguments, as their performances in front of the Cambridge crowd represented the oppositional dialogue defining the post-1960s conservative culture wars. Baldwin's critique of the American dream implicitly utilized the centuries-old Black radical tradition in his interrogation of the ideas, policies, and material outcomes of anti-Blackness rooted in the Atlantic slave system. In his defense of the American dream, Buckley evoked a deep reservoir of language and knowledge rooted in the maintenance, the conserving element of conservatism, of the racial hierarchical system of order in the nation's institutions. Both in their early 40s, Baldwin and Buckley represented two different intellectual poles in 1960s America, as well as two distinct understandings of history. Buckley, born into the white conservative Catholic family of an oil baron and lawyer, schooled in France and England, and later married to the daughter of a Canadian industrialist, developed the intellectual framework for the resurgence of conservatism with the establishment of the National Review in 1955 and later his television talk show, Firing Line, first airing in 1966. Buckley was critical in bringing together the three major strands of the new right: religious conservatism, libertarianism, and neoconservatism. Buckley's patient persistence helped navigate the culture of capitalism away from the dominant set of ideas instilled by the Great Depression and the New Deal, World War II, and the post-war Keynesian economics up through the 1960s. Rather than social welfare, Buckley's libertarian conservatism reimagined President Herbert Hoover's idea of a rugged individualism at odds with government intervention, ranging from low taxes to a renewal of states' rights regarding social relations. Moreover, Buckley's notion of individualism found root in what Nicholas Bukola calls inegalitarian libertarianism, a notion of freedom where only some people were sufficiently advanced to be free. For Buckley, the attention toward an imagined individualism wrapped in an inegalitarian libertarianism helped deflect the collective power white men wielded for centuries, which disavowed the white male monopoly on political, economic, and social power that culturally and legally justified the exclusion of women and people of color. Historically, this sense of individualism sheltered the white nationalist collective nature of American society from charges of constitutional hypocrisy. Consequently, the idea of human rights arising out of the experience of World War II appeared antithetical to conservatives, as they understood the concept's potential to dismantle the second-class citizenship of people of color, or even justify the welfare state. Conservatives, on the other hand, embraced the colorblind notion of individual rights. This sentiment, of course, harmonized with the massive resistance of segregationists in the 1950s and 1960s who claimed federal intervention interfered with one's individual right to decide whom they wanted to associate with. Sensing an ideological partnership, Buckley not only hired one of the segregationist movement's greatest defenders, James J. Kilpatrick, but the father of modern conservatism also vehemently defended Southern segregation in his National Review and in other media outlets. Buckley and the segregationists' embrace of individual rights without mention of race, in short, colorblind language, represented one of the vital pillars of neoliberalism. The embrace of colorblind individualism at the precise moment when the white nationalist structures of the nation confronted legislative censure provided a key anchor for the conjuncture leading to neoliberalism. In a rhetorical shift, the long collective nature of white superiority dissolved into a pure individualism, shaking loose the buried history haunting the longue durée legacies of freedom and slavery as the language-conserving hierarchies adapted to the new political context. Morrison, again, offers insight into the contradictions surrounding a rugged individualist American identity anchored to inegalitarian libertarianism, writing, "Autonomy is freedom and translates into the much-championed and revered individualism. White men, especially white men with property, had always embodied autonomy within the American historical context, freedom of movement, speech, and access to institutions, out of which emerged an existential and material state of individual freedom perceived as a given norm, including the freedom to discriminate." Considering federal action on civil rights to be unconstitutional social engineering and an undermining of pre-existing racial hierarchies, the conservative embrace of colorblindness regenerated the reverence for individualism, with the racial and gendered discrimination squeezed out of the historical record as if it never happened. In the new world of colorblind individualism, there were no groups of people, only individuals, abstractly isolated from the inherited legacies of racism and sexism. Through this imagining of the individual, innocence found regeneration. It was born again, alongside the myth of rugged individualism, despite a catalog of oppression. Meanwhile, the embedded ideas and material outcomes of settler colonialism and slavery would continue to inform American society. As white supremacy fell to social justice legislation, Buckley and his segregationist allies in the South began stressing this individual freedom just as the door of the welfare state opened for people of color and women. A post-civil rights world took shape. The welfare state, no longer exclusive to white males, was reimagined as a handout to those who just recently gained access. Now repelled by the economic system responsible for the post-war prosperity, discontented whites looked favorably upon the ideas of neoliberalism, its racial ideology of colorblindness, and its reforming of American anti-blackness through the language of culture and individual responsibility. As a best-selling novelist and essayist, Baldwin grew up poor in Harlem, eventually leaving the country to live and write in Europe. As he gained international recognition from a series of novels and collections of essays, the civil rights movement pulled Baldwin back to the United States in 1957, where he quickly became a sought-after spokesman for the civil rights movement. A central black intellectual of the time, Baldwin's rhetoric combined his working-class, Christian background from Harlem with his ability to speak the language of the white intelligentsia. In a series of nonfiction works, Baldwin's critiques during these years provided a counter to both the mainstream views of the civil rights movement as well as what would become black power. As an exemplar of the black radical tradition, Baldwin's critique contributed to the centuries-old tradition of resistance against racial antagonism by people of African descent in the New World. Exploding to life with the first group of enslaved Africans brought to the New World, Cedric Robinson describes the black radical tradition as an accretion over generations of collective intelligence gathered from struggle. In the daily encounters and petty resistances to domination, slaves had acquired a sense of the calculus of oppression as well as its overt organization and instrumentation. A genealogy of resistance rooted in slavery and maroon communities, and later post-emancipation forms of de jure and de facto segregation, informed this evolving tradition as it adapted to the changing process of racist oppression rooted in settler colonialism and slavery. We see this tradition's presence in the thoughts of Benjamin Franklin, who voiced the blueprint of the soon-to-be republic when he asserted, "Every slave might be reckoned a domestic enemy." Within a global sense, the enslaved as insurgent to European expansion formed the core of Paul Gilroy's counterculture of modernity. Baldwin's rhetoric and oratory built off these centuries-old traditions, blending the hope of Martin Luther King Jr. with the threat of Malcolm X. In the 1960s, Baldwin increasingly brought arguments rooted in economics into his arguments. The Baldwin-Buckley debate represents an early glimpse of the dynamics shaping the historical conjuncture in which neoliberalism took root in the American political economy. The culture war between the demands of civil rights social justice movements and the so-called white backlash or states' rights advocates who bristled against anti-racist federal intervention. The phrase white backlash too narrowly frames the historical ramifications of the era, as the concept obscures the deep contours of an American identity rooted in racism. In short, it implies a black provocation against a white presence innocent of past and present crimes of racial antagonism and institutional discrimination, obscuring the fact that for many white Americans, especially white men, Civil rights legislation represented a loss of centuries-old rights and entitlements over historically marginalized peoples, as the new laws dismantled the restrictions on opportunity for women, African Americans, and other people of color. An epical existential crisis of identity unfolded as this deregulation of hierarchies included a loss of normalized employment discrimination, whites-only housing in the North and South, access to credit, voting, sitting on juries, and the cultural loss of deference to white male authority. Unsurprisingly, this upsetting of deep hierarchies alarmed conservatives. In 1954, conservative intellectual Russell Kirk asserted, "What really matters is that we should accept the station to which a divine tactic has appointed us with humility and a sense of consecration." This cultural viewpoint mobilized various levels of higher authority, from God, a divine tactic, to notions of Western civilization in its imagining of order. The defense of Western civilization became a core element of the conservative movement and especially the circle of intellectuals Buckley recruited for the National Review. James Kilpatrick, a contributing editor to the National Review, echoed these sentiments in a 1963 essay arguing that social equality between white and black was anti-American. "This precious right to discriminate underlies our entire political and economic system." The proudly white supremacist essay titled, "The Hell He Is Equal," was held back by the Saturday Evening Post after the white nationalist terrorist bombing in Birmingham, Alabama, killed 4 African-American girls. Addie Mae Collins, age 14, Denise McNair, age 11, Carol Robertson, age 14, and Cynthia Wesley, age 14. Through today, however, culture war debates against the claims of social justice activists continue to evoke, indeed demand, an innocence toward the history of racial and sexual antagonisms, both disavowing the past and placing an emphasis on individuals rather than groups. Buckley made this clear in his attack on affirmative action in the late 1960s. "What one needs to consider is the individual who stands to suffer." His assertion, of course, dismisses the collective nature of white supremacy's privileging of white males at the exclusion of African Americans. Moreover, in the wake of civil rights legislation, Buckley insists that it would be unfair to have legislation helping historically marginalized groups if this meant interfering with individual rights. This denial of historical context would incessantly haunt the culture war arguments of conservatives for years to come. The Cambridge debate between Baldwin and Buckley underscores the two very different sets of language and knowledge anchoring the culture war. Mobilized in reaction to the demands of the civil rights movement, an ethos of anti-black antagonisms outlines the historical experience of people of European descent in the United States, a state of being defining the overall post-1400s European encounters with the New World, where the identity of whiteness, the West, or Western civilization, found its binary in the other, the enslaved, the alien, the savage, the heathen, the black. The dominant American attitude constructed through the processes of modernity, including the Atlantic slave system, settler colonialism, and patriarchy, shaped a vision of the world translating the violence required to ethnically cleanse Native Americans from their land, enslave people of African descent, and objectify women as property of men into a system experienced as a naturally ordered and righteous Western civilization led by white men. The notion of civilization, as many have noted, melded together the idea of progress into a culture emanating from these experiences and structures that helped Americans navigate and define their history and identity. The Baldwin-Buckley debate provides a snapshot of the contestation of the culture war ideals, with the historical moment weaving a systemic tapestry outlining the relationship of power to language and the possession of history. While Buckley's ethos possessed the progress-laden language and history of Western civilization to defend his argument, Baldwin's approach, on the contrary, foregrounded the Black radical tradition's subaltern position of the enslaved, the oppressed peoples, written out of history. This confrontation between systems of knowledge born out of the longue durée processes of settler colonialism and slavery represent the stakes of the 1965 debate at Cambridge, let alone the anchoring precepts of the post-1960s culture war and its struggle over buried history and its crisis of identity. Critical to this culture war struggle was the possession of the meanings of history. Framing of debate through the possession of history. Commenting in the last decade of his life on the nature of history, Baldwin discussed the inability of people trying to escape history and the effects of history. I have been living with those questions for a long time. You see, the trouble I am having right now is with the word itself. History means one thing in a European head. It actually means something else in an American head, and yet again something else in a Black man's head. To leave it at that is enough for openness. I am not sure any longer what the word means, especially as the white world now is calling on what it calls history to justify its dilemma without having the remotest sense of how they got to where they are. Because if history means something, it means that you have learned something from it. If you haven't, then the word has got to be changed. History in England or France or Germany or indeed in Europe is now meant as an enormous cloak to cover past crimes and errors and present danger and despair. In short, it has become a useless concept, except that it can be used as a stick to beat the people without history, like myself, over the head. That worked as long as I believed that you had history and I did not. And now that it is clear that that is not so, another kind of dilemma, another kind of confrontation begins. Perhaps history has got to be born for the first time. It is certainly true that all the identities coming out of history with a capital H are proven to be false, to be bankrupt. And in terms of America, the Americans are even more abject than the Europeans who are stifling among their artifacts, their icons, which they call history. The Americans have never even heard of history. They still believe that legend created about the Far West, the cowboys and Indians, and cops and robbers, and black and white.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.